I'd like to introduce our next speaker. Rajiv Mehta leads the nonprofit Atlas of Caregiving. He's also on the board of the Family Caregiver Alliance and co-organizer of the Quantified Self. For the past decade, Rajiv has led research on family caregiving and consumer health, advised healthcare organizations and technology companies, and developed consumer health products. Prior to his focus on health, Rajiv led innovation efforts at Apple, Adobe, Motorola, and other technology companies, and research at NASA. He holds a bachelor's degree in mechanical and aerospace engineering from Princeton, a master's degree in aeronautics and from Stanford, and an MBA from Columbia. Please welcome Rajiv Mehta.
Welcome, everyone. Hope you've had enough coffee at the last break. We're going through to the end. So as Richard mentioned, we've been working together for several years on caregiving issues and so forth. And I'm going to give you a glimpse into not so much technology for caregivers, but really how can we use technology to better understand caregiving. And as you sort of heard from the intro, my background and most of my colleagues is not in sort of the traditional areas of social work or healthcare or medicine of that sort. It comes from business and technology and from NASA, so we've sort of approached the whole issue in a very different way. But being humans, like everybody else, we all face the same caregiving issues. So it's just a different perspective on the challenges that we face. And this diagram came from a roundtable that Richard and I led now almost 4 years ago. We gathered together a group of experts around the country to say, how can we catalyze technology? And one of the things that came back was, in fact, how little we know about caregiving to be able to develop great solutions. And the fundamental point being that if we can't see, it's hardly likely that we will be able to solve it. And so the purpose of Atlas of Caregiving is to try to make the invisible visible. How do we understand caregiving, sort of the reality of the day-to-day experience of caregiving, much more visible, much more understandable, ways that we sort of innovators, whether that's policy or technology or services, can use to improve our efforts. But just as much recognizing that we caregivers are so busy doing the doing from moment to moment that in many cases we ourselves don't sort of consciously know all that it is that we're doing and how either good or bad different aspects of our situation is. So how can we help them make the invisible visible even just for us? And we're going about this in two ways. One we talk about as core research. And in this we're really innovating methods to study family caregiving. And some of this involves, you know, old-fashioned anthropology and ethnography. We talk to people. We go into people's homes. We observe. We see what they do. We listen to them describe their own situation. But then on top of that, we're taking advantage of a lot of new sort of methods and technologies. So we're using all these new sensors, wearable sensors, environmental sensors to gather other kinds of data. We're using new ideas to help people kind of keep track of their own activities or their moods or their sleep or so forth, who they interact with, more self-tracking to help them understand their situations better. And last year, we did a pilot study funded by the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation to use these ideas to see how could we look more deeply into families' lives. And we had 14 different families in the Bay Area participate. In each case, it was over a day, day and a half. And just actually by luck, we had an incredibly diverse group of families. So caregivers ranging in age from 30 to 73, care recipients ranging in age from 3 to 101, you know, all sorts of illnesses. Most people had multiple illnesses. In many families, there were multiple care recipients and multiple caregivers. So we actually got sort of the real world of caregiving rather than this isolated, here's the caregiver and here's the care recipient, and they have this one disease, which I have yet to really run into. And this slide is not meant to be read carefully, because you could go blind trying to do that, but rather to give you an impression of what we did. So Faye was a young woman caring for her mom, who's in her late 60s, who has Alzheimer's. And Faye has really had to sort of retire from her education career. She's sort of basically putting her PhD on hold because mom requires full-time care. And so we spent a day and a half with this family, and we interviewed them at the beginning and end of the session. We had Faye keep a very detailed log of her day. We had her wear one of those Fitbit-type devices to keep track of her movement. We had her wear a tiny little camera. It's so tiny, you can clip it onto your shirt, and it takes pictures every minute or so. We put environmental sensors in their home to get things like noise level, humidity, as well as motion detectors throughout the house. And the idea was, well, we thought these different ways of collecting data would be useful, but honestly, we didn't know. You have to try these things out and see what works and what doesn't. And after we got all that data, then we had this new challenge of, well, how do you make any pictures out of it? How do you present what you've learned? And so this collection of diagrams, which you can find online and so forth, showed the different ways that we tried to visualize the data. And on the top left is a diagram we call a care map. It shows sort of in a picture who is involved in this situation. Who are the people? Who cares for whom? Kind of how far away are they? How intimately involved are they? The diagram on the bottom left is sort of color coding different types of activities. So yellow is sleep, green is, you know, work, professional types of activities. All the blue is caregiving. And all of the diagrams ended up showing how incredibly fragmented the caregiver's day was. You know, you might add up all the little slivers and say, oh, it was only 3 hours. But honestly, it was spread out through the whole day, so it was almost always 24 hours. And so when you ask people, how much time do you spend on caregiving, which answer do you give, is a very real question. The diagram kind of in the middle on the bottom are just a collection of the photos taken by the camera. And as it turned out, for us researchers, the pictures were kind of useless. You'd get blurry walls, kitchen tables, the bathroom. But it turned out for the person wearing the camera, when we later came back and tried to talk, you know, what was going on at 1:30? You said you were really stressed there. Bringing that picture in front of them really brought back rich memories of that moment. So it was a blurry picture of the kitchen to us, but they knew what was going on. And so the camera turned out to be far more valuable than we thought. On the other hand, the motion detectors turned out not to be very useful at all. I think they were overly sensitive because there was lots of beeps going on when people weren't even at home. So we realized conceptually that kind of data could be helpful, but it would require a much more sophisticated analysis and technology. One of the key things that happened was we also discovered which of these methods of studying family caregiving could be useful to the people themselves. One example was we had people keep a log, and in almost every single case, people had their eyes open to their own situation by seeing what they had written down. One woman in her 50s caring for a son in his 20s who had various behavioral issues, when we had interviewed her before, and she had said, yeah, I'd probably spend about 2-3 hours a day caring for him. After she filled out her log, when we came back and talked about it, it was both funny and heartbreaking when she said, my gosh, I realize I no longer have to feel guilty about being tired. And it's like, well, yes, you're sort of awake all 24 hours, walking on eggshells. So people's eyes were opened, and we realized that some of our research methods could be turned into what we think of as practical tools that could help people better understand their own lives. And so we have a whole slew of these that we're working on. But one example in particular that's really caught on is this idea of a care map. And there are several examples there, the pretty ones in blue, which were from the pilot study. And as I presented these things in conferences, people resonated really well. You know, when I would describe Gaston's family by using the diagram, people got. And so we were asked, how can anybody create these things? And so eventually we came up with a method that you can see on the bottom there with pencil and paper, old-fashioned technology that people could draw their own. And we really developed kind of a how-to guide on doing this. And we wrote a blog post. You know, that's what one does these days. One of the benefits of not being associated with academia is you can publish anything, anytime. No peer review, nobody checks it, and people read it, and then they call you. And so one of the things that happened very fortunately was that we got a call from the Santa Barbara Foundation, who have been working really hard down in the Santa Barbara area to improve family caregiving there. And they asked, would you be willing to come down and sort of teach us how to do these care maps. And I said, well, it's all on the blog, but sure, we'll come down. Maybe there's some difference in teaching in person. And so you can see some photos here of people learning from us teaching how to draw care maps. And the whole thing turned out to be far more impactful than we had at all hoped for. One person there, one of our volunteers, had led the Coast Caregiver Resource Center for the last 40 years. So one would think she knows her community really well. And she commented that she had a much different appreciation of her community's caregiving needs after having participated in these workshops and having people draw their diagrams. And you can see here, these are that's a photo of a person drawing their care map with a pen, not a pencil, and some other examples on the right-hand side. So people drew these things, and it was so powerful that we've been invited back. So now we're working deeply with Santa Barbara County, with local social services agencies, grassroots organizations, the promotores, working with the local hospitals to really teach care mapping to both families as well as social workers to have a much richer understanding of their own lives. And we've had stories from people about how they've put these on their refrigerator walls and they've used them to talk to their family and so forth. So it's had a real impact. And which has also led to us, because we are in Silicon Valley, to develop a technology version of this. So we're working with one of the top design firms in the world to create basically a web application to draw care maps, which I think it loses some of the bodily aspect of drawing on the kitchen table, but on the other hand, there's lots of benefits to it as well. So we imagine over the course of the next year that's going to be very powerful. And in fact, it's led AARP as well as PBS to reach out to us to say, how can we bring this nationwide? So hopefully over the next couple of years, care maps will become very prevalent and will in fact catalyze much richer social conversation about caregiving. And then the last thing I just want to mention is we're now actually studying how do we teach families to use all these new technologies to understand themselves. So how do we guide them to use Fitbits and so forth to do their own thing? So that's it. The last thing I just wanted to mention is you can go to our website, atlasofcaregiving.com, to get information on the care maps. But just wait till Monday. We had hoped to have the website all revamped by this last Monday, but things go slowly. We'll take questions in after Blake speaks.